The next set of solutions really deal with improving the quality and timing of your sleep. Getting started right out the gate, the most important thing you can do to improve your sleep quality is treating your sleep disorder if you actually have one. There are a number of really easy solutions depending upon what your sleep problem actually is. Think about this from the perspective of a football player. They're probably more likely to be dealing with things like sleep apnea because they're larger, relative to, say, maybe a swimmer whose issue is more likely to be dealing with circadian rhythms because they're oftentimes practicing and training early in the morning. So right out the gates, just thinking about what we're asking our bodies to do gives us some strategies for what type of disorder we may likely have, and then, of course, then the solution for that. In order to make my solutions a little bit more straightforward, what I want to do is talk about getting to sleep faster and then staying asleep more effectively. So what are the reasons why people struggle to fall asleep and how can we improve that? It can be a number of different things. The obvious ones, but still important, are we using stimulants or caffeine too late for our own physiology? Some folks can metabolize caffeine very quickly and it doesn't affect them. Others really struggle if it's within, you know, 8 or more hours of sleep. It can affect their overall sleep quality. That's a common one. Working or doing any other stimulating events at night can be a problem. Where people really miss this is the best way to probably think about it is novelty. So it's not the fact that you're on your phone or the fact that you're watching TV or anything. It's seeking of novelty. That seems to be the big problem. So it's okay for some folks. I will be candid with you. I watch a little bit of TV basically every night before sleep. But what you don't want to do are things that cause you to seek novelty. And so your phone becomes problematic because something new will pop up and it'll reward that pattern of seeing something new and novel and get you excited. And so what you don't want to do is watch TV shows that are that. You don't want to watch things that are aggravating or arousing or exciting. You want to watch typically things that are more interesting but not overly stimulating. This is the planet Earth. This is not murder mysteries. This is not things that get you aggravated and irritated, like the news and political events and things like that. And so that is what you want to be cautious of. Eating too close to bed can be a problem. However, and this is important, people miss this, there is excellent research showing small snacks before bed can enhance sleep quality and reduce sleep latency. Specifically, kiwis are well studied as effective sleep aids. Higher glycemic index meals, pretty close to bed. Again, low amounts can be great. We certainly don't want to eat high amounts and increase digestion or heart rate and problems like that. But small snacks for some people can actually be really effective at putting you to sleep. Probably most important to all this, though, is really the pattern. And if you look around at any of the sleep research or talk to sleep experts, they're going to talk about the need to make sure that your sleeping environment is really a sleep sanctuary. Our body has probably one tool better than anything else, and that's the ability to pattern recognize. And this becomes a problem. If you go into sleep environments and you are anticipating a pattern of sleep issues, then that pattern is going to persist. If you have the opposite, then that pattern will persist. So what we see a lot of times are solution strategies for people having a hard time going to sleep, despite the fact that they're doing all these other things right. And this is common, right? Oh, I don't have caffeine. I stop working, many hours before. I don't eat before. I meditate before. I do breath work. I do all these things, and then I still struggle with sleep. Okay, great. I'm not watching TV, all those other things. Why am I still struggling to fall asleep? Well, oftentimes, it's the fact that you think about struggling to fall asleep that's causing that pattern to persist. So how do we solve that? We take clocks away. You don't get to measure, and you don't get to see your sleep score. You don't get to see your sleep latency number. You don't get to look at the clock and think about how long it's taken you to fall asleep. So all of those are also tools to take that out of the equation and reframe the approach into thinking, when I get into bed, this is an awesome opportunity to sleep, rather than, oh my gosh, I'm going to get into bed and have another night where I can't fall asleep. That's a bad framework to be in, and you want to get out of that as quickly as you possibly can. These environmental pattern recognition things are so strong, you can actually use it to your advantage, especially when traveling. Everyone knows of the first night effect, which is when you are in a new destination, you struggle to sleep the first night, but tend to sleep a lot better the second or third and subsequent nights. Well, a lot of that is because you're in a different environment, right? We aren't seeing and smelling and hearing the same things we did in our house. So if we can artificially create that in our house and take that on the road, we can dramatically improve our sleep quality and specifically our sleep onset. Think about smell as the easiest one. If you take a scent that you like, common ones are lavender. and you put a little lavender on your bed at night in your house every night, you tend to associate that smell with safe, secure, high-quality sleep, etc. You take that on the road with you then, put that on your new mattress or bed or wherever you go, those same scents will kick in, the same pattern recognition will happen, and ideally, you have the same quality of sleep. You can do a similar thing with temperature, right? If you have a set temperature of your bed, you may not be able to take that entire cooling mattress with you on the road, but there are things like cooling pillows. So you use that same temperature on your pillow at home, take that pillow or pillowcase with you, and now you have a mimicked environment. You combine a couple of different things like that, and you should really improve your sleep latency when you're on the road. Now, when it comes to staying asleep at night, there's a bunch of different solutions we can talk about. One of my most common ones is hydration. If you drink too much water, of course, you're going to wake up and have to urinate, and that's going to cause you to get up a whole bunch. But really, some folks don't understand that sleep quality will be a big determinant upon how frequently you get up to go pee. If you're waking up more than once and you go to pee, there's a large volume there, it is clear, and that's happening the next morning as well when you wake up and you still have a lot of pee, then you probably are in an issue of drinking too much pure water. In that case, just reduce your water intake for a couple of hours prior to bed, and you should be fine. Funny enough, we've had plenty of our high-performing clients, our high-performing executives in our coaching programs come to us with all kinds of problems with their physiology and performance and brain fog, and really all of it boiled down to the fact that they drank way too much water at night. It was tanking their sleep. We moved that, and within days, they're sleeping for 10 hours for the first time in 15 years. And I have so many examples of that where it's pretty silly, honestly, where I'm like, man, you spent a lot of money and time to figure out you drink way too much water at night. So it can be quite that simple. Other times, though, it's a little bit deceiving. So folks will oftentimes think that's a problem. If it's not the case, you're waking up and there's not a lot of volume there, or there is like one time and then the second time it's, you know, a lot less, or it's, you know, more yellow colored, or in the morning you wake up and realize you didn't even pee for 45 minutes after waking up. This is sometimes an issue of sleep quality. And so what happens is typically at night, you're supposed to be sending signals to your kidneys that says, hey, stop filtering and producing urine. And so obviously we don't want to be waking up to do that all throughout the night. If you're of a low quality sleep, though, for any number of reasons, that signal can continue to be sent, and so you can continue to make the urine. And so people think that their sleep quality is being ruined by the fact that they have to get up and pee, when the honest reality is they're peeing because they're already basically awake. And so that is another way to figure out, maybe I have a disorder, maybe I should get checked out, maybe something is going on because I'm waking up to pee a lot and really there's not a lot there. I probably should get checked out. Another really common one is sleep position. We see this routinely where 80%+ of people's sleep problems happen when they're on one position of their body. Most commonly, it's your back. And so avoiding sleeping directly on your back and sleeping either on your sides as a blanket rule, though not true for everyone, can really dramatically improve people's sleep. I've told this story earlier of one of my professional athletes I worked with having this issue, but we have seen this time and time again. And so getting some assessment or analysis of what's happening in your sleep position. This is a similar story to ergonomics. So making sure that your bed and mattress and pillow are all comfortable can also be really important factors to your overall sleep quality. Outside of that, we start now talking about environmental factors. You probably have heard ad nauseum about, of course, temperature. You want to be comfortable there, and we want to be probably a little bit cooler than we are during the day. But even noise, we want to be less than 35 decibels. Anything above that tends to create problems. This is where actually things like pink noise start to come into play. There's a lot of really interesting research coming out on that. It's a little bit deeper than white noise, and it's not really publicly available for the most part, but the research thus far is quite impressive. The issue with like white noise or sleep machines is the fact that above 35 decibels, they can actually create sleep problems because they're so loud. And so while it's great to kind of drown out the background information, you don't want to be in a position where you're actually too loud. Depending on where you live, if you're especially in an urban environment and you have lots of external sound stuff going on, you may want to actually turn to something like earplugs instead of a sleep machine for that purpose. Though earplugs may create problems with ear pain and discomfort and stuff like that. So again, choose the best tool that you have for your situation, but really below 35 decibels is the gold standard there. Again, ideally in the show notes here, we've got the link to my paper that you can go through all 11 factors. But other ones that are really common are CO2. There's emerging evidence that when that thing gets above 900 parts per million, and then really specifically in exaggerated scenarios of above like 2,400 parts per million, that this can dramatically impact sleep quality, sleep onset and sleep latency, as well as next day wakefulness, memory and decision-making, and a bunch of other cognitive performance tasks. So many, many other factors that go into your sleep quality, such as your environment, that we'll have in the show notes. Last thing I want to talk about here is snoring. Now, I don't want to overly concern you. Everybody snores at some point or another. It doesn't necessarily mean, it probably doesn't mean you have a sleep disorder, though it's not totally benign if you're a chronic or excessive snorer. That's really the problem here. It's not a normal function. It's common, but it's not normal. Now, one thing that's actually quite funny that we laugh about on my team a lot is how frequently people come into our programs because of sleep issues, and they've tried everything. They've done all the stuff we've talked about. They've had sleep studies done before, and they came back either like really moderate or nothing at all, and they maybe think their testosterone is low, or maybe it is, and they've run through everything like, I just cannot sleep. And we do one little test on them and realize, wow, has your sleep partner been assessed? Like, oh, my sleep partner just snores like crazy. And we always chuckle because I'm like, man, I got really bad news for you. Your sleep is fine, but your partner's sleep is a complete disaster and they're ruining your sleep. So we've had a lot of people come into our program and then basically switch. So the person that paid initially said, don't even do me anymore. Do this on my sleep partner, my husband or my wife or whatever, fix their sleep. And then that original person's sleep disorder, quote unquote, goes away immediately and permanently. And this has happened, like you can hear me literally laughing because it's happened so many times. And I don't feel bad about it because the people sleep perfectly afterwards because we found the real problem and it had nothing to do with them. And so snoring can be a real problem with sleep. And so really making sure that it's not you, it's not your sleeping partner, or in a lot of the cases, it's their dog. Not often cats are snoring that loud, but dogs, that's really, really common. And so that can be really disruptive to overall sleep. If it is you personally, we'll go back to that example, you can try just going with something like mouth tape. I've done that a ton. I use it a ton, especially using a combination of nasal dilators, so either nasal strips or something like that to open up your nasal passageways, as well as mouth tape. And I will be candid with you. We've had a lot of success with that. And sometimes that step alone really can improve snoring and solve a lot of sleep problems. It doesn't always happen though. So if it doesn't, then you probably need to go to the next step one way or the other, but it can absolutely be a viable solution and is a nice place to start. And just to be really clear, the next step I'm talking about is usually getting a sleep study done. But you can try other stuff as well. We've already talked about position is another common solution. Generally, people don't snore on their sides. If they do, not nearly as much or as loud as they are when they're on their back. So just try investing in one of those sleep pillows I talked about earlier that forces you to sleep on your left or right side. Sometimes that solves the problem immediately. There are also tongue exercises you can do. We can actually have a whole protocol here in the show notes. This is very free. It's going to take typically 4 to 8 weeks to have some sort of an effect, but there is strong research behind tongue strengthening exercises to resolve that problem. Sometimes there is no solution. It is anatomical, and you either have to have some sort of nasal surgery or put in some sort of a mouthpiece to resolve that problem. And then sometimes not even that works. But for the most part, something in that solution bin I just went over is going to either dramatically help, if not completely solve your snoring problems. If you enjoyed this clip, you can watch the full episode by clicking here.